Hello all. So in this section, let's discuss about NSAIDs. NSAID stands for non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Okay, it means non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. So they reduce inflammation. Okay. Now let's see what is the definition or what is the mechanism of action of these drugs. The definition of NSAIDs is that NSAIDs, they inhibit one enzyme known as cyclooxygenase enzyme. So NSAIDs, they inhibit cyclooxygenase enzyme. In short form, it is known as COX inhibitors. Okay, it is known as COX inhibitors. Now what is the function of COX enzyme normally? The function of COX enzyme normally is to synthesize arachidonic acid. It converts arachidonic acid into various prostaglandins. Okay, to convert arachidonic acid into prostaglandin as well as thromboxane. Now normally when this prostaglandin and thromboxane increases, remember, they cause fever, pain, inflammation, etc. So they are responsible for fever, pain, inflammation, etc. Now NSAIDs, they inhibit this COX enzyme, hence they inhibit the conversion of arachidonic acid into prostaglandin and thromboxane A2, hence they decrease fever, pain and inflammation. That is why they are also known as antipyretic, analgesic and anti-inflammatory. Okay, now let's talk about, before coming to the drugs, remember this COX enzyme, it is of various types. So types of COX enzyme. COX enzyme is generally of two types, that is COX-1 and COX-2. So cyclooxygenase enzyme is of two type. Now inside our cell, remember, some COX enzyme is already always present. That COX enzyme is COX-1. So COX-1 enzyme, remember, is a constitutive enzyme. Constitutive means it is always present and it is always functioning. So it is always present and always functioning. Because of this reason, it always functions. And in our body, normally some amount of prostaglandins are continuously synthesized. So this kind of function is known as housekeeping function. Housekeeping means, so it is constitutively or continuously working. But remember, when we require sudden inflammation, fever or pain, this COX enzyme suddenly becomes active. When it becomes suddenly active, it is known as inducible enzyme. Okay, so it's an inducible enzyme. It suddenly becomes active and it is responsible for sudden increase in excess of prostaglandin formation, which will lead to inflammation, and its symptoms. Okay, so COX-2 enzyme normally is an inducible enzyme and COX-1 is constitutive enzyme, continuously functions. But remember, COX-2 enzyme, in certain areas, it can be constitutive also. So remember, it is constitutive in kidney. In kidney, normally COX-2 enzyme continuously functions. Endothelial cells. So endothelial cells, brain and fetus. Here COX-2 enzyme can be constitutive just like COX-1. Okay. Now, there is another variety of COX enzyme, sometimes known as COX-3. Now, COX-3 is a variant of COX-1. It is a variant of COX-1 enzyme. But remember, this COX-3 is only found in brain. And right now we have found that this COX-3 enzyme is present in dog brain. In human, it is still to be confirmed. So it is found in brain, and in brain, COX-3 enzyme, remember, increases pain perception, and it increases fever. Okay, it increases fever, but remember, it has no role in inflammation. COX-3 enzyme has no role in inflammation. So it has only pain. Its only property is to increase pain and fever in brain. Okay. So I will be telling you that there will be a drug which will be inhibiting COX-3 enzyme. So if you develop a drug that's a COX-3 inhibitor, That drug will be only and only analgesic. Analgesic means it will decrease pain, and antipyretic. Antipyretic, that means it will reduce fever. Okay, but that drug will not be an anti-inflammatory. That drug will not be an anti-inflammatory. The classical example of that drug will be paracetamol. Okay, the classical example of that drug will be paracetamol. So paracetamol is only analgesic and antipyretic, but not anti-inflammatory. So let's classify now NSAIDs. So let's see what are the drugs we have NSAIDs, among NSAIDs. Okay, now NSAIDs, they can be classified into four types. The first one is non-selective COX inhibitor. Okay, non-selective COX inhibitors. Okay, now non-selective COX inhibitor, they inhibit COX-1 as well as COX-2 enzyme equally. Okay, they inhibit COX-1 and COX-2 enzyme equally. So when we are classifying NSAID, we know that they are COX inhibitors. Then we have preferential COX-2 inhibitors. Preferential COX-2 inhibitors. So that means these drugs, they will inhibit COX-2 more than COX-1. Okay, because the reason is that COX-2 enzyme is the main enzyme which is responsible for inflammatory signs. For inflammation, mainly COX-2 is responsible. So NSAIDs are anti-inflammatory molecule. And finally, we will write, we have selective COX-2 inhibitors. Selective COX-2 inhibitors. So these drugs, they will only and only inhibit COX-2 enzyme. Okay, then we have the drug which are non-COX-1 or COX-2 inhibitor. The drugs which will not act on COX-1 and COX-2. So these drugs are pure. We will write, these drugs will be having some other mechanism of action. And these drugs are known as analgesic, antipyretic. Analgesic and antipyretic with poor anti-inflammatory effect. Poor anti-inflammatory effect. Why? Because COX-2 enzyme was responsible for inflammation. These drugs, they do not act on COX-2 enzyme. Hence, they will lack anti-inflammatory effect. Okay. Now, we will be discussing these four classes of drugs. Okay. But remember, first point, that all NSAIDs, they inhibit COX enzyme. In which fashion? They all inhibit COX enzyme in a competitive, they are competitive plus reversible inhibitor. So they are competitive and reversible inhibitor of COX enzyme. So all NSAIDs are competitive and reversible inhibitor of COX enzyme. They inhibit COX enzyme in this fashion, except one, except aspirin. Okay, aspirin. Now aspirin is the only COX NSAID, remember, which inhibit COX enzyme irreversibly. So aspirin causes irreversible inhibition of COX enzyme. So the only NSAID which causes irreversible inhibition of COX enzyme is aspirin. Okay, now remember, any drug when binds to an enzyme reversibly, remember, it binds with ionic bonds. And any drug which binds to an enzyme irreversibly, remember, it binds with covalent bonds. Because covalent bonds cannot be broken, it cannot be broken down in a watery media. Ionic bonds, they dissociate easily. So aspirin, they bind to COX enzyme with a covalent bond or with irreversible fashion. So can we say that this COX enzyme will become permanently dead? It will become permanently dead. That is why irreversible inhibition is also known as suicide inhibition. It is also known as suicide inhibitor. So aspirin is a suicide inhibitor of COX enzyme. Okay, and suicide inhibitor are also known as HIT and RUN drugs. They will come, they will kill the enzyme, they will go out of the body, but the enzyme now is permanently dead, hence they will have a very long duration of action. Okay, so any drug which inhibits an enzyme irreversibly, remember, it binds with a covalent bond, and this is also known as suicide inhibition or HIT and RUN drugs. Okay, suicide inhibition or HIT and RUN drugs. Okay, so now before classifying drug, let's talk about certain common properties or common usage. Common use of NSAIDs. Okay, where NSAIDs are normally used. Okay, uses of NSAIDs. Now NSAID, remember, they are used as an analgesic. Analgesic means they will decrease pain sensations. Okay, analgesic. Now remember, they are effective in all types of pain. Effective in all types of pain. Especially inflammatory pain or tissue damage pain, except neuropathic pain. Because in neuropathic pain, the pain is not due to inflammation. It is due to abnormal conduction of a nerve. So NSAIDs are not effective in neuropathic pain. In neuropathic pain, we generally use anti-epileptic drugs like carbamazepine, phenytoin, etc. We also use antidepressant drugs like tricyclic antidepressants, etc. Okay. So in NSAIDs, they are given for pain relief. They are effective in all types of pain except neuropathic pain. They are also given as an antipyretic. Antipyretic means they will decrease fever. Okay, fever is the raised body temperature. And lastly, they are also anti-inflammatory. Anti-inflammatory. Okay, so these are the three common properties. But remember, there is a drug which is not an anti-inflammatory, that will be paracetamol. That will be paracetamol. Paracetamol is only and only analgesic and antipyretic. Paracetamol is only analgesic and antipyretic. It is not anti-inflammatory. It is not anti-inflammatory because it has no action on COX-2 enzyme. Okay. Now let's talk about other uses of these drugs. Apart from this, remember NSAIDs, they are uterine relaxants. They are uterine relaxants. The reason is the prostaglandins which are formed in our body, remember, they increase, they go and they cause increase in contraction of uterus. Prostaglandin causes contraction of uterus, and NSAIDs, they inhibit the synthesis of prostaglandin. Hence, they are uterine relaxant. Uterine relaxant drugs are also known as tocolytic drugs. Okay, the drug which is a uterine relaxant is tocolytic. Okay. So remember, these are the common uses of these drugs. Now let's talk about, they are also given for closure of patent ductus arteriosus. They're also given for closure of patent ductus arteriosus. Okay. And remember, there are three drugs which are approved for the closure of patent ductus arteriosus. The drug of choice is ibuprofen, which is an NSAID. A very commonly used drug is indomethacin. And aspirin can also be used. Okay. Because prostaglandin, they make ductus arteriosus open. Okay. They make ductus arteriosus open. Hence, we will decrease the level of prostaglandin. The ductus arteriosus will close. Okay, so these are the common uses. Now let's talk about the common side effects of NSAIDs. Common side effects of NSAIDs. Okay, now the most common side effect, the first one is, the most common side effect of NSAIDs are nausea and vomiting. The most common side effect of NSAID is nausea and vomiting. Okay, the most common. The second side effect in GIT is they cause peptic ulcers. They cause peptic ulcers. Now the point is, why they cause peptic ulcer? The reason is, suppose this is a stomach. In our stomach, there is an enzyme inside the stomach cell that is COX-1 enzyme. Okay, and COX-1 enzyme normally synthesizes prostaglandin E2. Okay, prostaglandin E2. And what is the function of prostaglandin E2? Prostaglandin E2 normally decreases HCl secretion by parietal cells. Okay, it suppresses HCl secretion and it increases bicarbonate secretion and mucus secretion. Now these bicarbonate and mucus, they form a protective layer over the stomach cell. They form a protective layer over the stomach cell so that HCl and pepsin enzyme, they cannot attack on stomach cells. Okay. Now the point is, NSAIDs, they inhibit COX enzyme. Because of this reason, they reduce the production of prostaglandin E2. Because of this reason, HCl level increases and protective level, protective factor reduces. Because of this reason, this protective barrier, they get reduced and HCl increases. It can lead to peptic ulcers. Okay. And maximum cause of peptic ulcer is by aspirin. Why? Because aspirin is COX-1 as well as COX-2 inhibitor. It inhibits COX-1 and COX-2. And it inhibits COX-1 and COX-2 irreversibly. Okay. But there are certain NSAIDs that do not cause peptic ulcer. Do not cause peptic ulcer. The first one we have is selective COX-2 inhibitors. Why selective COX-2 inhibitors will not cause peptic ulcer? Because prostaglandin, which is a protective factor, is synthesized by COX-1 enzyme. So they do not act on COX-1. No action on COX-1. And remember, selective COX-2 inhibitor, they are also known as COX-CYPs. They are also known as COX-CYPs, like rofecoxib, celecoxib. They will have a word COX-CYP in their end, etc. So they do not cause. And the second drug which will not cause peptic ulcer will be paracetamol. Why? Because paracetamol does not act on COX-1 and COX-2 enzyme. It has no action on COX-1 and COX-2, it rather acts on COX-3 enzyme. Okay, so selective COX-2 inhibitor will not act on COX-1 and paracetamol will also not act on COX-1. And these two drugs will not cause peptic ulcers. While aspirin causes maximum chance of peptic ulcers. Okay, now the third side effect of COX inhibitor is seen in kidney. Or NSAIDs is seen in kidney. Now suppose this is a kidney. Remember, the blood supply to the kidney. Suppose the blood is coming to the kidney. Kidney secretes a molecule known as prostaglandin I2. And this prostaglandin I2 causes vasodilatation. Because of this reason, there is increase in blood supply to the kidney. There is increase in blood supply to the kidney and the kidney will remain healthy. And due to increase in blood supply to the kidney, can we say they will cause increase in urine formation? Because urine is formed from the filtration of blood. So they will also increase blood formation. So this is the normal function of prostaglandin. So in urine, there will be water excretion. There will be sodium excretion. There will be potassium excretion out of the body. Okay, this is the normal functioning. Now if you talk about NSAIDs, okay, NSAIDs, they inhibit PGI2, and PGI2 in the kidney is synthesized by COX-2 enzyme. PGI2 is by COX-2 enzyme. Now, can we say that NSAIDs, whether it is aspirin, whether it is COX-CYPs, they all inhibit COX-2 enzyme. Okay, they all inhibit COX-2 enzyme. Hence, they will decrease the production of prostaglandin I2. NSAIDs in the kidney, they will reduce the production of prostaglandin I2. Because of this reason, Because of this reason, the blood supply to the kidney will be reduced. There will be vasoconstriction, and NSAIDs, they reduce blood supply to kidney. Okay, they reduce blood supply to the kidney. Because of this reason, what can happen? Let's see. As they reduce blood supply to the kidney, can we say that these drugs are nephrotoxic drugs? They are nephrotoxic drug. Why? Because they can lead to renal failure. Okay, and which part of the kidney will die first because of reduction of blood supply? That part of the kidney which is already reducing the receiving the least amount of the blood will be affected first. That least part of the drug is known as papilla. Papilla is the tip of the nephron. So these drugs, NSAIDs, they cause papillary necrosis, because tip of the nephron, it receives least blood supply. This is known as papilla, renal papilla, and this part of the kidney will die first. So this renal failure or nephrotoxicity due to NSAIDs is also known as, this property is also known as analgesic nephropathy. Analgesic means they are pain relieving substance, and their abuse can lead to nephropathy. Okay, so NSAIDs, they cause analgesic nephropathy. It's a very important point. Hence, continuous use of these drugs must be avoided. And because of this reason, one NSAID got banned. The NSAID that got banned, because it was causing papillary necrosis and analgesic nephropathy, that was phenacetin. So phenacetin was causing papillary necrosis, which is known as analgesic nephropathy. It got banned because of this reason. Okay, now the second point we must write, can we say that as we are causing vasoconstriction, less blood will be coming to the kidney, and hence because of this reason, the amount of urine which is produced will be less. So can we say that they will reduce urine production? As they will reduce urine production, remember they have anti diuretic effect. So they have anti diuretic effect. Okay, can we say they will reduce urine formation because of less blood supply to the kidney? Now, as they will reduce the urine production, can we say they will increase sodium, they will increase potassium, okay, level in the blood. In the blood, the level of sodium and potassium will increase, okay, and they will also increase the level of water in the blood, okay, because they have anti-diuretic. Because of this reason, these drugs, as there is increase in level of sodium and water in the blood, these drugs, they cause hypertension. NSAIDs, they cause hypertension. NSAIDs, they cause hypertension. NSAIDs, that means they increase blood pressure. NSAIDs, they also cause edema and fluid retention. Edema and fluid retention. Okay, so this is the side effect. Now, as they increase potassium level in the blood, remember they cause hyperkalemia. They cause hyperkalemia. Okay, so hyperkalemia could be dangerous condition. Okay, because as they are increasing the blood pressure in the blood, remember NSAIDs reduce the effect of all antihypertensive medication. Okay, they reduce the effect of all antihypertensive drug. Okay, NSAIDs, they reduce the effect of all antihypertensive drug, and can we say that NSAIDs, they are have antidiuretic action. NSAIDs, they also reduce the effect of diuretics. NSAIDs, they also reduce the effect of diuretics. So NSAIDs, they are bad for blood pressure, and they are bad if they are given concomitantly with diuretics. Okay, Now let's talk about the third side effects of NSAID, that is in blood. Okay, blood. Now in blood, remember there is an endothelial cell and there is a platelet. Okay, this is a platelet. Now remember, this platelet, it contains COX-1 enzyme, and COX-1 enzyme synthesizes thromboxane A2, and thromboxane A2 causes platelet aggregation. It causes platelet aggregation and the platelet attaches. Platelet attaches and it generally blocks the blood vessel. It generally blocks the blood vessel. If this blood vessel will get blocked, it can lead to myocardial infarction, stroke. If this coronary artery will get blocked, it will lead to MI and stroke. Because of this reason, there is a drug which will inhibit this COX enzyme in the platelet. That drug is aspirin. Aspirin has antiplatelet effect. Aspirin has antiplatelet effect. Why? Because it inhibits COX-1 enzyme, COX-1 inhibitor. Because of this reason, aspirin is the drug of choice for the treatment of MI and stroke. Aspirin is the drug of choice for the treatment of MI and stroke, and it is the only cardioprotective NSAID we have. It is the only cardioprotective NSAID. Okay, but if you talk about the drug known as selective COX-2 inhibitors, if you talk about a drug known as selective COX-2 inhibitors, okay, now remember, endothelial cells, they synthesize COX-2 enzyme. They synthesize COX-2 enzyme, and COX-2 synthesizes PGI2, prostaglandin I2 or prostacyclin. And it inhibit platelet attachment. Inhibit platelet attachment. So it is just opposite to thromboxane A2. If you will give a selective COX-2 inhibitor, what will happen? The level of COX-2 will reduce, but the level of COX-1 will remain normal or increased. So they have no effect on platelet. Okay. They have no effect on platelet, and rather they increase platelet aggregation. Why? They increase platelet aggregation because they reduce prostaglandin I2 level in endothelial cells. Okay? They reduce prostaglandin I2 level in endothelial cell. Hence the balance will shift towards thromboxane A2. Okay, because of this reason, these drugs, they have a side effect of, they cause MI and stroke. So selective COX-2 inhibitor, they themselves can cause MI and stroke. Okay, and because of this reason, certain selective COX-2 inhibitor, which are known as COXIPs, they got banned, like roficoxib, valdecoxib. Because of this reason, they got banned. And I will be telling you that other COX-2 inhibitor, they comes with a warning that they can increase the risk of MI and stroke. Okay, they also increase the risk of MI and stroke. Now let's move forward. As we can say that aspirin has an antiplatelet effect. The platelet will not aggregate. Hence, the side effect of aspirin will be bleeding. The side effect of aspirin will be bleeding, okay? While the side effect of COX-2 inhibitors will be aggregation or thrombosis. Just opposite thing. Thrombosis means blockage of blood vessel. Okay? So selective COX-2 inhibitor causes thrombosis and aspirin causes bleeding. Okay? Now let's talk about the fourth side effect of these drugs. Remember, NSAIDs, they cause allergic reactions. They cause allergic reactions. Now, why they cause allergic reaction? Because let's see why. We know that there is a molecule known as arachidonic acid. Arachidonic acid normally goes into COX pathway, cyclooxygenase pathway, where it synthesizes prostaglandin and thromboxane A2, which causes inflammation. okay? But remember, this arachidonic acid can also goes into LOX pathway. LOX stands for lipoxygenase pathway, where it forms leukotrienes. Okay, like LT, B4, C4, D4, etc. Okay, now remember, these leukotrienes, they cause allergic reactions. They cause allergic reaction or anaphylactic reactions. Now the point is, if you will inhibit COX enzyme by NSAIDs, the arachidonic pathway will be diverted towards leukotriene. Hence NSAIDs, they increase leukotriene levels. They increase leukotriene level. Because of this reason, they cause severe allergic reactions like, let's write certain examples, they cause angioedema. Okay, they cause Stevens-Johnson syndrome, they cause various idiosyncratic reaction, they can lead to anaphylaxis. It can lead to anaphylaxis. On the skin, they can cause urticaria also. They can also cause urticaria on the skin, which is also, and they can also cause asthma. They can also cause asthma, and they can also cause ethmoidal polyp. They can also cause ethmoidal polyp. Because of this reason, it is implicated that when we give aspirin and other NSAIDs, it is generally associated with asthma and ethmoidal polyp. In asthma, there will be shortness of breath. And this triad of aspirin, induced asthma and ethmoidal polyp is known as Samter's triad. It is known as Samter's triad. So aspirin on long term is associated with increased risk of asthma and ethmoidal polyp in the nose. Okay, so these three things is known as triad. This is known as Samter's triad. Okay, so these are the common side effects of NSAIDs. Okay, these are the common side effects of NSAIDs. So now let's discuss about the drugs which we have among NSAIDs. Okay, so let's talk about the names of the drugs and their property among NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Okay, so the first class of drug that we will be discussing will be non-selective COX inhibitors. Okay, non-selective COX inhibitors. So non-selective COX inhibitors, they will inhibit COX-1 equally and COX-2 equally. Okay, inhibitor, they inhibit both COX enzyme. Now non-selective COX inhibitor, the first drug we have is aspirin. The first drug we have is aspirin, and remember, aspirin is the only irreversible COX inhibitor. Rest all other drugs among NSAID and even in this group will be reversible inhibitor. They all will be reversible inhibitor. Okay, so let's talk about first a very famous drug, that is aspirin. Okay, so let's make a heading, aspirin. Aspirin. Now aspirin, it is also known as acetyl salicylic acid. Salicylic acid. It is the chemical structure of aspirin. That is why aspirin is also known as salicylate. It is also known as salicylate. Okay, the chemical nature. Now let's see the uses of aspirin first. Uses. Now, when aspirin is given in low dose, that is around 40 to 320 milligram per day, remember, it has selective antiplatelet effect. It has selective antiplatelet effect. Because of this reason, aspirin is the drug of choice for MI, myocardial infarction, stroke, and Berger's disease. ओके, बर्जर्स डिजीज. बर्जर्स डिजीज, बर्जर्स डिजीज इज अ टाइप ऑफ पेरिफेरल वैस्कुलर डिजीज इन विच द आर्टरीज इन द लिम्स दे गेट ब्लॉक ड्यू टू अटैचमेंट और फॉर्मेशन ऑफ प्लेटलेट थ्रोम्बाई. इन एम आई एंड स्ट्रोक देर विल बी प्लेटलेट थ्रोम्बाई इन रिस्पेक्टिव कोरोनरी आर्टरीज एंड सेरिब्रल आर्टरीज. ओके, नाउ इन मीडियम डोज ऑफ अराउंड 500 टू अराउंड 800 मिलीग्राम इट हैज एंटी पायरेटिक, दैट मीन्स इट विल रिड्यूस फीवर एंड एनल्जेसिक इफेक्ट. एनल्जेसिक इफेक्ट एज एन एंटी पायरेटिक, एज एन एनल्जेसिक इफेक्ट. एंड इन हायर डोज ऑफ अराउंड 2 to 5 grams पर डे, पर डे रिमेंबर इट हैज एंटी इंफ्लामेटरी इफेक्ट. इट हैज anti-inflammatory property. Now the point is, as an anti-inflammatory drug, remember aspirin. As an anti-inflammatory drug, aspirin, it is the drug of choice. Aspirin is the drug of choice for rheumatic fever. Okay, rheumatic fever or acute rheumatic fever. It is also the drug of choice for rheumatoid arthritis. It is also given in osteoarthritis. Arthritis means inflammation in joints. It is also given in a very dangerous condition, Kawasaki disease. Okay, Kawasaki disease. Here there is inflammation of vessels, blood vessels known as vasculitis, which can be very dangerous. Okay, so these are the conditions. Now the point is, as a role in antipyretic and analgesic, its use has been declined. Use has been declined now. Because if there is a viral infection, if there is a viral infection, remember aspirin can cause a very dangerous disease or dangerous complication known as Reye syndrome. So because of this reason, if there is fever due to viral infection, it can lead to Reye syndrome. So it could be very dangerous. Now what is Reye syndrome, that we will discuss shortly. Okay, now let's see certain other miscellaneous uses of aspirin. Certain other miscellaneous uses of aspirin. Okay, now aspirin, it is also given, aspirin, it is also given for colorectal cancer. Okay, colorectal cancer, in cases of colorectal cancer. Now the point is, in which cases of colorectal cancer, we will write aspirin is given in familial adenomatous polyposis. Now this is a pre-malignant condition and it can convert it into malignant colorectal cancer. And remember, prostaglandins, they increase the malignant transformation of familial adenomatous polyposis. Hence we inhibit this prostaglandin by giving NSAID, and the drug of choice is aspirin. So aspirin inhibit the malignant transformation of familial adenomatous polyposis into malignant. But remember, there is one drug which have found to be effective, that is Sulindac, that we will be discussing shortly. But remember, the drug of choice is aspirin. Okay, drug of choice is aspirin. Now low dose of aspirin, it is also given in Alzheimer's disease. In Alzheimer's disease, we give low dose of aspirin because it has found to be, not a very great evidence is there, but there are some evidence of neuroprotection, that it inhibit neurodegenerative process of Alzheimer's disease. Okay, so it is also given in Alzheimer's disease. And lastly, aspirin is also given for the treatment of ACE inhibitors. ACE inhibitors are antihypertensive drug, induced dry cough. Their characteristic side effect is dry cough. And ACE inhibitor is also, aspirin is also given for niacin induced flushing. Niacin induced flushing. So treat their side effect, we also give aspirin. Okay, we also give aspirin. So these are the certain uses of aspirin. Now, let's talk about certain precautions while giving aspirin in certain population. Remember, when you are prescribing aspirin, certain precautions should be taken in diabetic patient. If a patient is of diabetes mellitus, give aspirin with great precaution. Why? Aspirin can lead to hypoglycemia. Aspirin can lead to hypoglycemia in diabetics. Okay? Because the reason is prostaglandin E1 in our GIT. Remember, it inhibits insulin release normally. So if you will give aspirin, it will inhibit PGE1, thus there will be sudden insulin release which can lead to hypoglycemia. Now, second precaution that must be taken of aspirin is in cases of children who are suffering from viral infections. Viral infection like influenza virus, chickenpox virus, etc. Now remember, how would we will able to know that they are suffering from viral infection? Because these viral infection, the patient or the children will present with fever and rash. So if a patient is coming with fever and rash, there could be these viral infection, and we cannot give aspirin. We will not give aspirin as an antipyretic drug to control fever in this condition. Why? Because aspirin in children with viral infection can lead to a very dangerous side effect known as Reye syndrome. Aspirin can lead to Reye syndrome. So this subgroup of population is the most susceptible to Reye syndrome. Now, what happens in Reye syndrome? In Reye syndrome, there is hepatic encephalopathy. Now, what is hepatic encephalopathy? There is sudden liver failure, and due to liver failure, the toxic substance will go into the brain, which can lead to encephalopathy, and it has a very high mortality rate. Okay, it has high mortality rate. There is no specific treatment, there is only supportive treatment. So Reye syndrome could be a dangerous complication in children with viral infection. Why it occurs, we don't know. So it's a kind of idiosyncratic reaction. Idio means idiopathic, syncretic means suddenly it happens in certain genetically susceptible individual. Third point, aspirin should not be given in gout patient. Okay? Why? Aspirin in gout patient, remember, it increases uric acid level. And gout occurs due to already increase in uric acid level. Okay? Uric acid level. But remember, generally we give the drugs, and so aspirin generally increases uric acid level. But remember, there are certain NSAIDs that decrease uric acid level. These are tolmitine, apazone, etodolac, and very high dose of aspirin. Remember, aspirin in very high dose reduce uric acid level, but in normal dose it increases uric acid level. But in very high dose or toxic dose, it will have an opposite effect. So let's see what is the effect of aspirin on uric acid. Effect of aspirin on uric acid. Now remember, when you will be giving aspirin, generally in low dose, that is less than 2 grams per day. Okay? And in less than 2 grams per day, remember, aspirin increase uric acid level in blood. In blood, it increases uric acid level. In the dose of 2 to 5 grams per day, and at the dose which is a toxic dose of more than 5 grams per day. Now, in this dose, aspirin has a variable effect. It may increase or it may decrease, unpredictable. But in very high dose, remember, it reduces uric acid level in blood. Why? Aspirin has uricosuric property. It removes uric acid into the urine. It increases excretion of uric acid into the urine. But remember, this toxic dose generally we don't employ in our patient. Okay, we don't employ. Now let's talk about the side effect of aspirin. The most common side effect of aspirin is nausea and vomiting. Okay? Aspirin in long term usage can lead to peptic ulcers. And for the treatment of peptic ulcer due to aspirin, remember the drug of choice is proton pump inhibitors. Proton pump inhibitors are the drug of choice, but you can also give synthetic PG even from outside because the level of prostaglandin E decreases. So we give misoprostol. Okay, so we give misoprostol from outside, but remember the drug of choice is proton pump inhibitors. Now the other things which we have already written, aspirin causes various types of allergic reactions. Aspirin causes Semter's triad, and aspirin, it also leads to Reye's syndrome. Okay, it can lead to Reye's syndrome. Now let's talk about a topic known as aspirin poisoning. Aspirin poisoning. Now aspirin poisoning is also known as salicylism. It is also known as salicylism. Now remember, what is the fatal dose of aspirin? The fatal dose of aspirin is more than 10 grams. It is around 10 to 30 grams. But remember, children are, as compared to adults, they are more susceptible. And in them, toxicity can occur even in lesser dose. Even in lesser dose than 10 milligram, the children fatality can be seen. So children are more susceptible as compared to adults. Okay, so in lesser dose toxicity can be seen in children. Now, and remember, if aspirin blood level is more than 50 milligram per deciliter, it's an indication to do hemodialysis. It's an indication to do hemodialysis. Now let's see what are the clinical features of aspirin poisoning and how to manage it. So what are the clinical features and how to manage it? Okay. Now the most common clinical feature we already know is nausea and vomiting. Nausea and vomiting, which can lead to dehydration. And due to excessive loss of electrolyte in vomitus, it can lead to electrolyte imbalance. Electrolyte imbalance. Second point, we will write that it may cause hyperthermia. Aspirin causes increase in body temperature or hyperthermia. Why? Because aspirin reduces sweating. Because of reducing sweating, the body temperature will increase. There will be increase in body temperature. Also, aspirin causes tinnitus in ear, hallucinations in brain, and it also leads to hypoglycemia. It can also lead to hyperglycemia, but remember, hypoglycemia is more common. Okay, hypo is more common. So hypoglycemia, hallucination, hyperthermia, this could be dangerous. Okay, now how to, what is generally seen? If we talk about acid-base imbalance, generally when we give aspirin, aspirin generally goes directly to the respiratory centers in our brain, and aspirin stimulate respiratory centers, hence there is respiratory alkalosis. Why? Because of hyperventilation. Because of this reason, there is alkalosis in the blood. Remember, alkalosis in the blood binds to potassium, and potassium will be excreted out. It can lead to hypokalemia. It can lead to hypokalemia, and potassium also enters into the cell during alkalosis. Okay, then remember, aspirin level inside the blood gradually increases, which can lead to itself metabolic acidosis. It can lead to metabolic acidosis, high anion gap. Okay. Now the point is, this point is very transient. This phase of respiratory alkalosis is very transient and easily reversible. But this is the permanent phase or irreversible phase. This need to be corrected. Okay, so this need to be corrected. So this is the most challenging phase. Now let's see how to manage a treatment of aspirin poisoning. Okay, so to control nausea and vomiting, we must give anti-emetic drugs. We give anti-emetic drugs. Okay, to control hyperthermia, there must be external cooling. External cooling. Okay, and we will write to treat this hypoglycemia, glucose should be given. Glucose should be given. And remember, there is bleeding, so sometimes we need to give blood transfusion with vitamin K if there is bleeding due to antiplatelet effect of aspirin. So this is the symptomatic management of the symptoms which is generally seen. Now the next thing we have to do is we have to remove unabsorbed aspirin which is taken by mouth. So we must give gastric lavage. We must give gastric lavage with activated charcoal. Okay, and to correct this acidosis, which is the most dangerous, remember we do forced alkaline diuresis. We do forced alkaline diuresis. Now forced alkaline diuresis is given by a alkaline substance, that is sodium bicarbonate. Now why we give sodium bicarbonate? The first point is to remove aspirin in the urine, because aspirin is an base acidic compound. If we will change the pH of urine basic, aspirin will become ionized or water soluble and it will be easily excreted out in urine. And also this sodium bicarbonate will correct metabolic acidosis. To correct metabolic acidosis, we give this sodium bicarbonate. That is why this sodium bicarbonate is known. It is not for aspirin poisoning. The antidote for aspirin poisoning is considered to be sodium bicarbonate. Okay, and the last resort is generally hemodialysis. And we know if the level is very high in the blood, we directly take out the blood of the patient and we do hemodialysis. So what is the antidote for aspirin poisoning? That is sodium bicarbonate is considered antidote for aspirin poisoning. Okay, now let's, apart from aspirin, let's talk about other non-selective COX inhibitors. Other non-selective COX inhibitors. Okay, so all these drugs will be reversible. So all these drugs will be reversible inhibitor. Okay, chaliye, let's talk about the drugs. The first drug we will write is piroxicam and tenoxicam, and we will write their special properties. As you see, piroxicam and tenoxicam, cam word is coming, they will continuously do work or calm. Remember, they are longest acting NSAIDs. Longest NSAIDs. The reason is, these drugs, they undergo enterohepatic reabsorption. That means these NSAIDs, they are generally excreted out in bile. They are excreted out by bile in the liver. Instead of ingested out in feces, they again come in back into the blood and they again undergo enterohepatic reabsorption. That is why these NSAIDs are the only NSAID which is given once a day for control of inflammation and fever. Piroxicam and tenoxicam are given once a day. So the longest acting overall is piroxicam. Okay. Now, next drug we have is ketorolac. Ketorolac. Now, ketorolac is an NSAID which can be given intravenously or intramuscularly, and it is used as a post-operative analgesic agent to provide post-operative pain relief after operation. But remember, for post-operative analgesia, the drug of choice is opioids or morphine. Okay? But remember, when we give ketorolac, ketorolac has equal efficacy. It has equal efficacy. That means the effect of ketorolac is equal to morphine. Okay? Equal efficacy to morphine. So it can be given. It's a very good drug which can be given in post-operative analgesia because morphine carries a risk of respiratory depression. Ketorolac will not have risk of respiratory depression. Hence, it will have an equal efficacy. Okay, so remember this part. Now, the next drug we have is indomethacin. Indomethacin. Now, indomethacin, remember, it is the drug of choice for the treatment of inflammation in arthritis. Okay, so in which arthritis it is the drug of choice? We will write it is the drug of choice for reactive arthritis seen in infections like chlamydia, psoriatic arthritis, gouty arthritis. Okay, so it is the drug of choice. Okay, it is also the most commonly used drug for the closure of patent ductus arteriosus. For the closure of patent ductus arteriosus, but remember now the drug of choice has become ibuprofen. Why? It is more preferred drug because it is safer as compared to indomethacin. So we will be discussing about the side effects of indomethacin. So before coming to the side effects of indomethacin, remember there is a drug known as Sulindac. Sulindac is a prodrug, that means it's an inactive drug, and its active metabolite is indomethacin. So the active metabolite of Sulindac is indomethacin. Okay? Now let's see what are the side effects of indomethacin you we must know. So most common side effect of indomethacin comes in CNS. Okay, and more than half of the individuals they experience frontal headache. Frontal headache. So generally it is given for the treatment of headache as an analgesic agent, but it itself causes headache. Hence, this property of indomethacin is known as it causes paradoxical increase in pain. Okay, paradoxical increase in pain. Okay, and in CNS it also causes imbalance. Imbalance is ataxia. It causes abnormal thoughts, psychosis. It also can precipitate seizures. Okay, precipitate seizures. Because of imbalance and seizures and psychosis, this indomethacin is absolutely contraindicated in those people who require a lot of attention and focus. Like it is absolutely contraindicated in pilots, drivers, machinery operators. Okay, machinery operators. It is also contraindicated in patients who have a history of epilepsy. Epilepsy patient. It is absolutely contraindicated in epilepsy patient. Okay? So indomethacin, remember, causes paradoxical headache. Now, indomethacin, we have found that there are certain cases of pancreatitis which have been reported with indomethacin. Indomethacin can also leads to pancreatitis. Okay? Now let's talk about other drug, that is nabumeton. Okay, nabumeton is a basic NSAID. Generally, NSAIDs are acidic drug. Nabumeton B for basic drugs. Okay. Next drug we have is ibuprofen, a very famous drug. Ibuprofen. Ibuprofen is considered to be the safest NSAID for the treatment of inflammation. And remember, it is the most preferred drug in children because it has least risk of allergic reactions and Reye syndrome. That is why. So it is considered to be the safest drug. Because of this reason, this Bufrin is generally considered to be the drug of choice for closure of patent ductus arteriosus. It is also the drug of choice for post-operative dental pain. Okay, post-operative dental pain. Okay, now what is the specific side effect of ibuprofen? The specific side effect is it leads to aseptic meningitis. Ibuprofen can lead to aseptic meningitis. Now, from this ibuprofen, we have made certain congeners like ketoprofen. We have made flurbiprofen. Okay. Now, these drugs are given as an eye drops also for the control of inflammation in conjunctivitis, etc. Okay. Now, this ketoprofen, it has additional bradykinin antagonist property. It blocks the receptors of bradykinin. It is also a bradykinin antagonist property. Because of this reason, it is also given in allergic diseases. It is also given in allergic disease like allergic conjunctivitis. It is given in cases of allergic conjunctivitis. Now the next drug we will write is naproxen. Okay, now naproxen is the only cardio-safe NSAID that does not increase the risk of MI after aspirin. Remember, aspirin is the most cardio-safe NSAID. Apart from aspirin, naproxen is considered to be the next most cardio-safe NSAID. It doesn't increase the risk of MI. Okay. Remember, next drug we have is mefenamic acid. Mefenamic acid. Now, mefenamic acid is considered to be the drug of choice for menstrual pain. That is also known as dysmenorrhea. This condition is also known as dysmenorrhea. Okay, and remember, this mefenamic acid has additional, apart from COX inhibitor, it also has additional prostaglandin receptor blocking property. It is also a prostaglandin receptor blocker. And the last drug we have is phenylbutazone. Phenylbutazone. Now, phenylbutazone is one of the most efficacious analgesic agent. That means it can relieve pain, which can be comparable to opioids. Comparable to opioids, it can relieve pain. Opioids are the best painful relieving substance. But remember, this phenylbutazone has been banned because it's a sulfa containing drug, and any drug which contains sulfa can lead to serious allergic reactions like agranulocytosis. So this phenylbutazone got banned because of the increased risk of agranulocytosis. Now, what is agranulocytosis? A means not happening, granulocytosis, that means neutrophils are not dividing. Okay, agranulocytosis means not happening granulocytosis. So these are the various non-selective COX inhibitors. So let's talk about now preferential COX-2 inhibitors. Preferential COX-2 inhibitors. So preferential COX-2 inhibitor will inhibit COX-2 enzyme more than COX-1 enzyme. Okay, so we don't want unwanted effect of COX-1 like peptic ulcers. Now let's see what are the drugs. We will write a mnemonic N. MAID. Okay. So the first drug we have is nimesulide. सुलाइट. तो निमेसुलाइट इज अ ड्रग प्रेफरेंशियल कॉक्स टू इनहिबिटर, बट रिमेंबर इन मेनी कंट्रीज इट हैज बीन बैंड. वाई? बिकॉज इट कॉजेस हिपैटोटॉक्सिसिटी. इट इज हाईली हिपैटोटॉक्सिक एंड इट कॉजेस मोस्ट कॉमन इट कॉजेस स्टीवन जॉनसन सिंड्रोम. इट लीड्स टू सिवियर स्किन डिजीज. स्टीवन जॉनसन सिंड्रोम, द एपिथीलियम ऑफ द स्किन विल बी पील्ड ऑफ एंड इट इज एब्सोल्यूटली कॉन्ट्राइंडिकेटेड इन चिल्ड्रन. इन द कंट्रीज वेयर इट इज अवेलेबल लाइक इन इंडिया, इट इज कॉन्ट्राइंडिकेटेड इन चिल्ड्रन लेस देन 15 ईयर्स ऑफ एज. इट शुड नॉट बी प्रिस्क्राइब टू द चिल्ड्रन लेस देन 15 ईयर्स ऑफ द एज बिकॉज देर इज एन इंक्रीज रिस्क ऑफ स्टीवन जॉनसन सिंड्रोम. देन एम फॉर वी हैव इज मिलोक्सिकैम, एसिक्लोफेनेक, डिक्लोफेनेक एंड इटोडोलैक नाउ अमंग देम दिस डिक्लोफेनेक, अमंग ऑल एनसेड दिस डिक्लोफेनेक व्हेन अप्लाइड टॉपिकली ऑन स्किन, इट हैज बेस्ट टिश्यू पेनिट्रेशन. ऑल्सो इट हैज बेस्ट साइनोवियल जॉइंट पेनिट्रेशन. दैट मीन्स वेन इट इज गिवन टॉपिकली और ओरली, इट हैज द बेस्ट पेनिट्रेशन दैट इट विल एंटर इन टू साइनोवियल फ्लूइड. फ्रॉम द ब्लड, वेन इट इज गिवन, इट एंटर्स इन टू जॉइंट साइनोवियल फ्लूइड. And in joint synovial fluid, remember its concentration as compared to the blood becomes 3 times. It gets permanently deposited here. Because of this reason, it's a very good drug for the treatment of arthritis. So it has a synovial concentration is generally more than 3 times, which is achieved. So if it is in blood, it is 1. There will be 3 times concentration of diclofenac, which will be achieved in synovial joint. And it is also applied topically on the skin. And it comes with a brand name known as Voviron. Voviron cream. Okay? Voviron creams. Now, let's talk about selective COX-2 inhibitors. Remember, selective COX-2 inhibitor, they are also known as, they will end with the word COXIPs. Now, the good advantage of using this selective COX-2 inhibitor is, that they do not cause peptic ulcers. Because peptic ulcers is due to reduction of COX-1 enzyme in stomach. But what is the disadvantage? The disadvantage is they increase platelet aggregation. Because they inhibit endothelial cell prostaglandin I2 that we have discussed. Because of this reason, they increase the risk of MI and stroke. Why? Because they lead to vascular thrombosis. Now, if you compare the benefit versus risk, the benefit is no peptic ulcer. This is the benefit. But if you talk about the risk, that is MI and stroke, which is more dangerous, so their risk is sometimes more as compared to the benefit of peptic ulcer. So the risk is more. Because of this reason, certain COXIPs, they got banned. The COXIPs that got banned are Rofecoxib and Valdecoxib. Rofecoxib and Valdecoxib, they got banned because they were increasing the risk of myocardial infarction and stroke. They are cardiotoxic and they are not good for the brain. Okay, but remember the available, the other COX inhibitors, COX-2 inhibitor, they come with a warning. Other COXIPs, they come with a warning that they increase the risk of MI and stroke. Other COX-2 inhibitors, they come with a warning that they increase the risk of MI and stroke. So let's see what are the drugs we have. The first drug we have is Lumerococcib. Lumerococcib is the longest acting COX-2 inhibitor. and it is the most selective COX-2 inhibitor. But the point is, this lumerocoxib also got banned. Why? Because it was causing liver failure or it was hepatotoxic. It was causing hepatotoxicity. So right now, certain drugs which are approved are, we will write, okay, approved drugs are etoricoxib, paricoxib, and celecoxib. So these are the drugs, and they are used as an anti-inflammatory drug. They are used as an anti-inflammatory drug, especially in the cases of arthritis patient, etc., and in other inflammatory conditions. So these are the selective COX-2 inhibitors we have. Okay. Now the last group of NSAIDs we have is analgesic, antipyretics, okay, with poor or no anti-inflammatory effect. Okay, poor or no anti-inflammatory effect. Now why? Because these NSAIDs, they will not be acting on COX-1 and COX-2 enzyme. So they will have no action on COX-1 and COX-2 enzyme, because they were responsible for inflammation, because they will be having some other mechanism of action. Okay, and remember, these NSAIDs, they have a great advantage that these NSAIDs, they do not cause peptic ulcer. Because peptic ulcer was due to inhibition of COX-1 enzyme, and these NSAIDs, they do not increase the risk of MI and stroke like COX-IPs, because they do not affect on COX-2 enzyme. So any drug which inhibit COX-1 enzyme increase the risk of peptic ulcer, and COX-2 increase the risk of MI and stroke. Okay, so remember this part. So let's see what are the drugs we have among analgesic and antipyretic. So first we will write the list of the drugs. Okay, the first drug we have is paracetamol, which is also known as acetaminophen. Another name of paracetamol is acetaminophen. The next drug we have is phenacetin. Third we have is metamizole. And lastly, we have is nifopam. Okay. Lastly, we have is nifopam. Now the point is, we will be discussing paracetamol in great detail. Okay, we will be discussing in great detail. Now, what is the mechanism of action of paracetamol? Remember, paracetamol is believed to act on an enzyme known as COX-3 enzyme, or on a receptor known as TRPV1 receptor. So we will discuss what is that. Okay, TRPV1 receptor. Now, what about phenacetin and metamizole? Phenacetin and metamizole, they are believed to act on the sensory tracts of spinal cord. Okay, sensory tracts of spinal cord in a same fashion, just like paracetamol. Okay, but remember, and nifopam, we will write, nifopam is an SNDRI. That is, it is a serotonin, S for serotonin, N for norepinephrine, D for dopamine reuptake inhibitor. So by inhibiting the reuptake, it will increase the level of these amines, serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine in the brain. Okay, but remember, this phenacetin, it has been banned. Why it has been banned? Because this phenacetin was causing papillary necrosis. The kidney was getting damaged which was also known as analgesic nephropathy. It was known as analgesic nephropathy. Now, where this nifopam is, where these drugs are used, remember nifopam, it's a very good drug for the treatment of migraine. And it is also given for to control post-anesthetic shivering. It is also given to control post-anesthetic shivering. Okay. It is also given to control post-anesthetic shivering. Now, what about metamizole? Metamizole is a very commonly used drug for controlling perioperative pain during operation. It is also given for colicky and cancer pain patient. Colicky and cancer pain patient. So they are given for pain. So let's make a heading paracetamol. Okay. Let's make a heading paracetamol or acetaminophen. Okay. Now, this paracetamol, it is the most commonly used. It is the most commonly used OTC medicine. OTC means over-the-counter medicine in the world. Okay. So it is a non-prescription drug. It can be directly obtained from a chemist. Now, what is the mechanism of action of paracetamol? Now, exact mechanism of action of paracetamol is unknown. Okay, but there are two proposed mechanism of action. The two proposed mechanism of action is paracetamol reduce synthesis of COX-3 enzyme, which is present in the brain. Which is present in the brain. Okay. But remember, this COX-3 enzyme still have not been identified in human brain. It has not been identified in human brain. But remember, this COX-3 enzyme has been identified in dog brain. Okay. Now, the second proposed mechanism of paracetamol is that this paracetamol, these nerves in our brain, they release certain cannabinoid. Endogenous cannabinoid. One of the cannabinoid which is released in our body by the nerve is anandamide. Now, this anandamide generally is reuptaken by the same neuron. It is reuptaken by the same neuron. Okay. Now, this paracetamol inhibit the reuptake of anandamide or cannabinoid. So, it inhibit reuptake of cannabinoids like endogenous cannabinoid like anandamide. Hence, the level of anandamide and cannabinoid will increase, and this cannabinoid act on other neurons. The receptors of cannabinoid on other neurons are known as TRPV1 receptor. Okay, TRPV1 receptor. Okay, and this, by stimulating this receptor, they reduce pain. They reduce pain sensation. Okay, so it is another proposed mechanism. So it acts on TRPV1 receptor, increases the activity of cannabinoid on TRPV1 receptor. So these are the two proposed mechanism of action. Okay, now what is the dose of paracetamol? Remember, paracetamol is one of the safest drug we have. But remember, recently there has been an FDA warning that a single tablet of paracetamol, a single tablet of paracetamol, PCM is paracetamol, should not exceed 325 milligram of active paracetamol in it. So a single tablet of paracetamol should not have more than 325 milligram of paracetamol in it. Okay, because above this dose, it can increase the risk of poisoning or toxicity. So the dose of paracetamol in a single tablet should be less than 325. Okay, now let's talk about paracetamol toxicity or paracetamol poisoning. Okay, paracetamol poisoning. Now, Paracetamol poisoning, if we talk about it, is again more common in children. Children are more susceptible as compared to adults. Okay? And the fatal dose or the fatal dose of paracetamol is around 250 milligram per kg. This is the fatal dose. Okay? Now, how paracetamol poisoning occurs? To understand that paracetamol poisoning, we should know that how paracetamol is degraded in our body. Okay? So let's talk about metabolism of paracetamol. Okay? Metabolism of paracetamol. So when we give paracetamol PCM, this paracetamol goes to the liver. It goes to the liver, and first this paracetamol by phase one reaction, the phase one metabolic reaction, which is carried out by an enzyme cytochrome P2E1 enzyme, it converts paracetamol into a metabolite known as NAPQI. Okay? It converts paracetamol into a metabolite known as NAPQI. Now, after this NAPQI is formed, this NAPQI is excreted out in urine. It is excreted out or removed out of the body. Now, if it is given in normal dose, remember, it gets undergoes phase 2 reaction. Phase 2 reaction will convert NAPQI into water soluble group. And in phase 2 reaction, we will attach glucuronide group. Glucuronide makes it water soluble and it is excreted out in urine. Okay, so the phase 1 reaction is carried out by CYP2E1. Phase 2 is carried out by glucuronide conjugation. But remember, if it is occurring in toxic dose, if a person has taken in high dose, then extra amount of this paracetamol is excreted out in urine by glutathione conjugation. It is excreted out by glutathione conjugation. So now it needs glutathione and then it will be excreted out in urine. So in toxic dose, what is required is glutathione. Okay, now let's see why paracetamol poisoning occurs. Now PCM toxicity occurs due to accumulation of NAPQI. This NAPQI molecule is highly toxic. Okay, this NAPQI molecule is highly toxic. Okay, now what this NAPQI can cause? Let's see the clinical features of this paracetamol poisoning. So this NAPQI is highly toxic because it contains free radicals, and this free radicals will cause free radical mediated damage, and the characteristic damage is seen in the cases of liver only. It damages most commonly the liver part only, and it leads to hepatotoxicity. It leads to hepatotoxicity. This is the most characteristic toxicity of paracetamol. Okay, that NAPQI which is accumulated can lead to hepatotoxicity. Okay, so let's see what is the overall clinical features or presentation of a person who generally comes to us with paracetamol poisoning. Okay, paracetamol poisoning. So the clinical features are, when a person consumes high dose of paracetamol in early, less than 12 hours, generally the most common sign and symptoms of paracetamol poisoning is nausea and vomiting. Nausea and vomiting. It can also lead to abdominal pain, and it also leads to liver tenderness. There will be tenderness in hepatic circle. Now, in the time period of 12 to 48 hours, this is a very dangerous time period. It leads to the classical toxicity, that is hepatotoxicity. Hepatotoxicity. Okay. It can also lead to nephrotoxicity, kidney damage. Okay. And it can also lead to hypoglycemia. These features are seen, but this is the most characteristic part, that is hepatotoxicity. And more than 2 days or 48 hours, the patient will present with you with jaundice. So jaundice will appear after 48 hours. Okay, jaundice will appear after 48 hours. Now, what is the pattern of hepatotoxicity which is seen in cases of paracetamol? So it leads to centrilobular paracetamol. How it damages liver? We will write it leads to सेंट्रीलॉबुलर नेक्रोसिस विद पेरीपोर्टल स्पेयरिंग. It leads to centrilobular necrosis with periportal sparing. Now, what does it mean? We know that in a liver cell, there is a central vein. And liver hepatocytes, they are arranged diagonally. They are arranged diagonally like this. And on one part, we have a portal triad. Portal triad. Now, when we give paracetamol, the cells of around central vein, they become destroyed. These cells around the central vein, they become destroyed. So centrilobular necrosis, while the cells around this portal triad will be spared. Okay, the cells around portal triad will be spared. So this is the characteristic hepatotoxicity pattern which is seen in cases of paracetamol poisoning. Okay, it can also lead to renal tubular acidosis. Okay, in cases of kidney damage, it can lead to renal tubular acidosis. Now, second point is, what are the factors that increase the risk of paracetamol hepatotoxicity or paracetamol poisoning? These risk factors, they will increase NAPQI formation or NAPQI accumulation inside the cell. It will lead to paracetamol hepatotoxicity. Now, what are the drugs? The first we will write, paracetamol toxicity is seen. PCM toxicity is mainly seen in cases of alcoholics. PCM toxicity is more common in cases of alcoholics. Why? Because alcohol stimulate or induce CYP2E1 enzyme. Alcohol induces CYP2E enzyme, and alcohol depletes the stores of glutathione. Alcohol depletes the stores of glutathione. Now let's see, what does it mean? Now alcohol, if it induces CYP2E1 enzyme, if it increases the activity of CYP2E enzyme, more paracetamol will be converted into NAPQI, and it alcohol depletes glutathione store. NAPQI will not be excreted out in urine, it will get accumulated in the body. Okay, similarly we will write that is why if a patient is having an alcohol, PCM should not be given. It should not be given if a person is suffering from hangover. In hangover, the patient has headache, so person should avoid taking paracetamol in an hangover after taking alcohol. And similarly, isoniazid and zidovudine also increase the risk of paracetamol toxicity, and it is believed that isoniazid and zidovudine also induce CYP2E1 enzyme. Okay, they also increase the risk of paracetamol hepatotoxicity. Okay, now how to monitor? Now remember, hepatotoxicity risk is increased. There is increased risk of hepatotoxicity if blood levels of paracetamol is more than 200 microgram per ml at 4th hour after the ingestion of paracetamol, or if it is still more than 30 microgram per ml at 15th hour of ingestion of paracetamol. So after 4 hour, if it is more than 200, and after 15 hour, if it is more than 30 microgram per ml in the blood, then there is increased risk of hepatotoxicity. Okay, and how to monitor it? Hence we make a graph. In this graph, we make the blood concentration of paracetamol, and we see with time. Okay, and we see the concentration of paracetamol, it should always be less than this. Our goal is to make them less than this. So this graph of monitoring the paracetamol concentration in the blood is known as Rumack, Matthew normogram. Okay, this graph is known as Rumack Matthew normogram to monitor paracetamol
poisoning. Now let's see what is the treatment of paracetamol poisoning. How to treat it? Treatment, okay, of PCM poisoning. First, we have to remove unabsorbed PCM which is present in the stomach. Okay, we have to remove it. We have to remove unabsorbed paracetamol. Now, how we can do? Unabsorbed paracetamol can be given by giving emetics. We will induce vomiting. We can do gastric lavage. Okay, by giving activated charcoal. Activated charcoal will bind to unabsorbed paracetamol. Okay, but remember, these measures are given only up to 4 hours of ingestion. Okay, 4 hours of ingestion. After 4 hours, they should not be given. Okay, emetics, gastric lavage, and activated charcoal, they should not be given after 4 hours. Now, the antidote of paracetamol poisoning. Now, the antidote of paracetamol poisoning is N-acetylcysteine. Okay, N-acetylcysteine is considered as an antidote of paracetamol. Now, what is the mechanism of action of N-acetylcysteine? N-acetylcysteine regenerate the stores of glutathione. Okay, it regenerates the stores of glutathione. Why? Because this N-acetylcysteine has an antioxidant effect just like glutathione. It's an antioxidant molecule. It regenerates the stores of glutathione. And it is the most effective drug we have for paracetamol poisoning. N-acetylcysteine. But remember, what are the alternatives to N-acetylcysteine? They will act by the same mechanism. We can also use methionine. And cysteamine is also found to be effective. Cysteamine is also found to be effective. Okay. And what are the other options? How we can remove this paracetamol which has been absorbed? We can do forced alkaline diuresis. And we can also do hemodialysis. Okay. But the best treatment we have is to give N-acetylcysteine for the treatment of paracetamol poisoning. So this is all about NSAIDs. So thank you very much.